Hi everyone and welcome back to the channel. This is part 3 of chapter 8 of ISCA CA final old syllabus. In this video we'll be discussing a lot of concepts apart from cloud computing. That is, we'll discuss on mobile computing, green computing and the BYOD, then social media and web 2.0 and finally web 3.0. These are the 5 concepts that we will be discussing as part of this video. The first one is of mobile computing. Mobile computing has 3 key components. The first one is of mobile communication, which is the mobile networks. It could be either based on Wi-Fi or the 4G networks that we use. Then we have mobile hardware, which is the actual physical device which we use for this mobile computing. A smartphone or a tablet PC can be an example of this. Then finally we have mobile software, which is the operating system and the other applications that we install in our mobile. So it could be an Android or an iOS and all the other applications that we use as apps in our mobile phone. So these are the 3 components of mobile computing. And the best example for mobile computing, we can take the example of a banking app. So if we install a SBI online or if we install a HDFC bank app, then we can do everything that we want in our bank account by using our mobile device itself. And this paragraph here, they have given on how the mobile computing works. And this is pretty simple. Whatever they have described, you can just look at it and go through. Next we'll discuss on the benefits of mobile computing. They have given a lot of rubbish here. There are only 2 points that is actually given here, and that is the fact that we can get remote access by using our mobile devices. We can access it from anywhere. So if we are working in an organization and if we have to work from a client site, we can take our laptop to the client site and work there. So we'll remotely access the organization's network to perform our work, but we'll be actually working from the client side. The next one is real-time updates. So if we are working from the client side, we can't come to the organization and get into the organization's physical network to actually perform the work. We can provide real-time updates from that remote location itself by using our laptops or mobile devices or whatever we are using for the work. So these are the only 2 benefits that are given here. If you have any better benefits that you can think of, you can write that also in the exam. The only 2 benefits given here are remote access and real-time updation. Next we look at the limitations of mobile computing. So the limitations of mobile computing and issues of mobile computing, they are more or less similar. You can read both of them together. Limitations, the first one is regarding bandwidth. A mobile network is naturally slower than a comparable Wi-Fi network. Wi-Fi is much faster compared to the mobile network. But nowadays, we use 4G networks from Airtel, Jio or the other providers in India, and it's pretty fast, but it's still not exactly as fast as a Wi-Fi network. And then we have security issues when working from mobile network. This, they are comparing a mobile network with a LAN network. LAN is definitely much more safer and secure, and it is also faster when compared to any mobile network. And LAN is more secure when we compare it to a mobile network. But what we can do is we can implement a VPN so that we can get into the organization's private network through the internet by using this VPN. That is a workaround for the security issue. And then we have power consumption. We have batteries in mobile devices, and batteries definitely run out faster when compared to plugging in and using the device. So the workaround could be by using power banks or by putting the devices to charge when we are working. Next we have transmission interferences. This is usually the case in mobile networks and not in case of wireless LAN networks. So if we are traveling from one place to another, and if the network is switching between different towers when we are traveling, then we get these transmission interferences when we switch from one tower to another. That can be a cause for concern. So there could be call drops, or suddenly our internet could go and then come back again, and that could be an issue. So what is the workaround for this? There is no specific workaround for this. We should sit in one place and work. We can't be traveling and working. If we are traveling and working, this is going to be an issue, at least for the present time. Then we have health hazards. Health hazards related to the radiation that is emitted from mobile devices. What is the workaround? Keep the device a bit away from the body when working. Then human interface with the device. This is not an issue actually. We can enlarge the screens if we have to see something that is small. Then in issues, we have to look at the first few points, that is regarding security. They talk about the confidentiality, integrity and availability of the data that is transmitted using mobile networks. It is obvious that a mobile network is less secure compared to a wired LAN network. And what can we do to work around with this security? We need to put in VPNs when we are working, or we need to come up with some kind of encryption for the data that we are using. Otherwise, there could be possibility of eavesdropping that is done on the transmission that is happening. Then bandwidth. Bandwidth at the moment, we don't have any solution. 4G networks are there, but they're still not as fast as a LAN network. But now 5G is also coming, and that could be a kind of comparable to the existing Wi-Fi standards. So that is a we are progressing in as far as this bandwidth is concerned. Then location intelligence, again, whatever they have given there is total rubbish. It is something which we looked at above in transmission interferences. When we switch from one tower to another, there can be call drops or there can be issues with the network. That is what is talked about there. And then power consumption, plug it in and use it, or take power banks and chargers. And the next one is revising the architecture. This is an important point. Not all websites or applications are mobile friendly. Some of them still require you to log in using the desktop or a laptop itself. The best example is ICAI's own exam website. If we want to see the exam results, sometimes it does not allow us to log in using our mobiles. We have to log in using a computer, that is a PC or a laptop. So the technical architecture of the websites have to be altered for accommodating mobiles. Then after that, we have, there are not many other issues. We have things about reliability. That is, once we get more towers installed, then the communication is more reliable. Then integration with legacy and mainframe emerging applications. This talks about the interface between wired and wireless networks. With that, we are done with mobile computing, and now we move on to green computing. In green computing, we look at the meaning and the best practices of green computing. The meaning of green computing is the study and practice of environmentally sustainable IT. So we have to use computers in such a manner that it is environmentally sustainable and we don't harm the environment. What are the best practices? We look at it now. For the best practices, you can use this code word GCP, ESP, RPC, RCE. If you come up with something better, then you can use that. Or else, this is something which I have come up with and it could be quite useful for you as well. GCP stands for Green Computing Plan. Then ESP stands for Environmentally Sound Purchase Decisions. Then RPC stands for Reduce Paper Consumption. Then RCE is for Recycle and CE is conserve energy. So that is GCP, ESP, RPC and RCE. The first point would be to develop a green computing plan. Every organization, they should come up with a plan on how they can reduce their emissions or their resource consumption when they are using their computers. They should come up with a proper plan, and that plan could be crowdsourced from their employees itself. So they can ask their employees or other people to give them the best ideas on how they think that they can be going green as far as computing is concerned. And once they get ideas from their employees, those ideas can be converted into a plan, and that plan can later on be implemented. And the next one is ESP, that is environmentally sound purchase decisions. So before the organization invests in any new computing resource, they should also think about the environment as one of the factors in that investment. It is not just financial factors which they need to consider. They should also consider the impact on the environment because of that purchase decision. So the points they have given here is that they need to use server virtualization so that they can use the latent or the wasted capacity of that server in a more efficient manner. They'll be using the resource to 100% rather than wasting that resource which is available. Then they should have a clear and consistent criteria for the design of products. The product design should be environmentally sustainable. And then the other points, you can make it up yourself in the exam and write it. Then we have RPC, which talks about reducing paper consumption. So this talks about the fact that we should not be unnecessarily using paper to print documents. Rather, we can look at the documents in the system itself by using things like track changes, which is a feature in the Microsoft Word. We can look at what is the change between the previous version and the current version, instead of printing both the documents and manually comparing them. Then we can use online marketing rather than printing out physical pamphlets and things like that. So we'll ultimately have to reduce the paper usage that we are doing. It is more a move towards a paperless concept. Then we move to RCE, which is recycle and conserve energy. Recycle is the fact that we should be recycling the e-waste rather than just disposing them off or throwing them to the oceans and other places. As far as possible, all these electronic waste should be taken to recycling plants, whatever is the useful parts from that. So there are a lot of metal elements in the electronics. They would have used titanium, nickel, cadmium and other materials, or steel and things like that in the electronic products. All these things can be salvaged and recycled instead of being thrown somewhere. Then we should talk about conserving of energy, and they have given certain guidelines here on how to conserve energy. These are very simple things. You can think about this yourself in the exam and note down. They have given that use notebook computers rather than desktop because they consume less space and also less power. Then use power management features and turn off the hard drives when you don't use them. Power down CPU when you are not using it. And the next one is try doing the computer tasks in intensive blocks of time, and switch off the hardware at other times rather than using it intermittently across the day. Then employ alternative energy resources. All these are things which you can make it up yourself and write it in the exam. Then this next paragraph, it talks about the fact that an organization or a green service provider or a consultant who is going to advise organizations on these green computing practices, they should analyze the customer's IT usage, IT infrastructure, and then they should adapt the green technologies to that particular client. If the green technologies are not adapted or not suited for that client, then there is no point trying to force them to adopt green technologies. It should be adapted for that client. The next concept, which is the third concept here, is on BYOD, that is bring your own device. This is a concept where employees bring their own devices to work and they work on their devices. They don't work on devices provided by the organization. And why do organizations do this? There are certain advantages for that. The reason is happy employees. People are most happy when they work on their own systems rather than on systems which are provided by the organization. And this is also kind of psychological, because we'll be happy when we work on our devices rather than things which are provided by someone else. Then the second one is lower IT budgets. The organizations don't have to spend for procuring laptops and things like that for the employees. They will get it on their own. Third one, reduces IT support requirement. This one is kind of questionable, because even though employees are not given organizational laptops, they might still need the support from the organization as far as the organization's IT applications and things like that go. So there can be a slight reduction in this IT support requirement, but it is not a 100% reduction, or it is not a drastic reduction. The next one is early adoption of new technologies. People are most happy to update to the latest gadgets and latest things that are there in the market. So it is obvious that if the organization has to adopt a new technology, it will involve a lot of cost. It needs to change the laptops or the software for every single employee. But if it is done from an employee's end, they will invest their own money and get it done. So it is cheaper for the organization, and also they'll be updated. The last one is increased employee efficiency, closely connected with the first one. The psychological feeling of being happy will automatically increase the efficiency of the employee. But BYOD is not 100% accepted or 100% good. The reason is there are certain threats. The first one is threats to the network. And then we have application related threats. And the third one is device risks. First we look at network risk. Is the fact that there are many devices which are connected to the organization's network, and some devices might not even be detected in the organization's network. So they can't clearly establish a scope or a broad perspective on how many devices are connected, who are the ones who are using the organization's network, whether they are authorized users or not. So those things are risk to the organization. Unauthorized users may get access to the organization's network, or in case there is any attack on the organization's network, they can't estimate the scale of the damage that is being done. If everyone uses the organization's laptops itself, then they will have a proper count and they can easily detect the scale of damage or the penetration that has occurred. But if they're using their personal devices, this is more difficult to detect and resolve. Next we have application related risks. If employees are using their own laptops for performing the work, they may have other applications in their laptop which are there for their personal use. Those applications may interact and harm the organization's applications and work. So imagine that you are working in your organization in your personal laptop. You might have games, you might have other photo editing applications and things like that. In case there is any virus or malware that has come into your laptop because of these applications, that may corrupt data related to your organization. That is a serious risk which organizations cannot take. The last one is device related risks. Devices can be lost. If it is an organizational laptop or a desktop, you will leave it at the organization itself and then go home. You need not take it home in a lot of places. But if it is your personal laptop or mobile, you will be carrying it around everywhere, and the chances of the device getting stolen are much higher. So that is device related risks. And the relation between mobile computing and BYOD is that mobile computing is kind of synergic with BYOD. If people bring their own devices, then mobile computing also gets a big push, and it can be like the presence will be felt much better. So that is what is talked about here. Now we move on to the next concept of social media and Web 2.0. Web 2.0, the major points in this paragraph are that there are two major contributors to this Web 2.0. That is the usage of AJAX, asynchronous JavaScript XML, and the RSS and Eclipse softwares. So these are the things which actually drive the Web 2.0 and made it such a big success. The difference between Web 1.0 and 2.0, it is given here that the web moved from a read-only platform to a read-and-write platform. Instead of only organizations and specific persons putting out data and everyone else reading it, now users can also interact with other people on the web. So it is a two-way interaction on the web. Then what are the different components in a social network? There are communities. We talked about earlier when we were discussing the cloud platforms, there can be community clouds. So for example, XBHP, TeamBHP, these are pages or platforms dedicated for automotive enthusiasts. They can connect over these platforms. Then we have this thing called RSS. RSS is not Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh. It is called Really Simple Syndication. The thing is, instead of you going to every website in order to check the latest updates, those websites can send you the updates directly on your news feed. So here is my mobile device. So here there is a page of Autocar India asking whether it can send a notification to me. So if I press allow there, then any news story that comes up there will be sent to my Google homepage. So whenever I open my Google homepage, I'll be getting notifications from that website. That is how RSS works. Then there is blogging, you can write blogs. Then Wiki is a collection of pages. Wikipedia is the best example for that. Then Folksonomy, where they'll classify the information available on the web. And then we have mashups, which is like using two existing technologies to create something completely new. So that is mashups. Then we have different types of social networks. For it could be specialist networks, it could be for mixed networks, it could be for artists, it could be police. All these are different types or usages of the social networks. Then we have life cycle. It starts with a need, then an initial set of members form the network, and after that they conduct meetings, have discussions, share data. If the goal is achieved, they can close it, or they can again continue the discussions. That is how the life cycle of a social network exists. This is very simple and logical to understand. Then applications of Web 2.0. These are only some of the applications which they have given. There are many more applications apart from this as well. Web 2.0 led to the creation of social media. It led to the creation of online marketing and also drastic changes in education. Apart from this, there are many other sectors where the internet has revolutionized. So you can give any examples apart from this also. Next, we come to the last concept, that is of Web 3.0. In Web 3.0, it talks about semantic web or data web technology, which means that instead of users talking to each other, machines talk to each other here. Like there are many interconnected devices that we have, our homes, our cars, mobiles, everything are interconnected with each other, and they use this Web 3.0 to work. Then there is this semantic web, which is the platform for these devices to interact with each other, and there are web services for the same. With that, we come to an end of this part 3 of this video and also the end of this chapter. Hope you learned something out of this. and a lot more is available about these on the internet. So I'll try posting some links about them as well. Thank you for watching, and hope you stick for the further videos as well.